January has come, and with it, the strange beginning of a new year with all of its hope, its promise, its complexities. On one hand, we are faced with a world of possibilities, and we think of all the things that we're going to accomplish this year, who we might be, what we might do. And on the other hand, as winter settles in around us, it seems to settle into our hearts as well. Our thoughts grow quieter, more serious. This time of year is appropriate for a contemplation of the less popular aspects of life. Trees are stripped of their majesty and they're laid bare before us. The once vibrant grass has lost its luster. And the frozen lakes echo the steely sky. Most of the animals have gone too, hibernating or migrating until the spring. Winter is monotonous, heavy, and uncomfortable. And so it is when we turn to the sadder, harder parts of life. The barren landscape of the winter months seems to echo our internal landscape when we experience grief, loss, and death. When I asked for suggestions for worship themes for this church year, I received several requests to center services on death, loss, and dying. I actually got those same requests last year, but I declined to jump into that in my first year of ministry with you. I wanted to know you better before coming to such a tender and an important subject, more than I was avoiding it. And as we all know, I didn't avoid it very successfully. So when several people made the same request again this year, I felt like the time had come. So here we are. It should be noted, though, that our monthly worship theme is not sadness, loss, or brokenness. It is wholeness. I decided to put a positive spin on these subjects for two reasons. One, I don't believe that we can be broken. We can feel broken, but that doesn't last forever. No feeling lasts forever, even though it might seem like it will at the time. And secondly, the best hope for any experience of loss is not to ignore it, to make it go away, but to really feel it, to integrate it with all of our other experiences, thus bringing that experience into the wholeness of who we are. And this congregation has experienced its share of losses during my year and a half as your minister, just a week ago. I'm acutely aware that this sermon arrives 2 days before yet another memorial service for a beloved member of this community. These past 2 years, several other members of the church have died, as well as your spouses, your friends, your parents, your children. There have been losses unnamed and unknown. Some of those deaths were unexpected. Some happened at the end of a long illness. In at least one case, the death was the result of violence, and another was a suicide. To know the death of another is to be reminded of our own death. There are also those among us who suffer with terminal illnesses, chronic illnesses, those who have lost or who are losing their independence. Some of you struggle with eating disorders, some of you struggle with addictions, and still others carry with you traumas of war, poverty, abuse, and injury. All of these prefigure death, and so they force us to acknowledge its constant presence. To be alive and to know that we will die is the very definition of an existential crisis. We are profoundly free. fragile beings, and we know this from a young age, as we heard our children express a few minutes ago. How we cope with the knowledge of our impending death is determined primarily by culture. We are given a set of attitudes and beliefs about death from our parents, from religion, from society at large, various cultural markers. And in the United States, we are particularly terrible at dealing with death. It is something that we tend not to talk about very honestly or very openly, and yet we fetishize at the same time. And when we don't talk about something, really talk about it, we convey that it is shameful, inappropriate, impolite, or just plain wrong. We internalize the message that talking about it is wrong, and so our path to knowing how to cope with death is fraught. Furthermore, our cultural silence about death implies that death itself is somehow shameful and wrong. I had a rather shocking encounter with this a few years ago when I was training to become a minister. Now, some ministers trot out their clinical pastoral education stories for shock value, and I promise that's not what's going to happen. So if you're bracing yourself, just know that's not where we're going. So I was doing clinical pastoral education, which is where a person training for the ministry spends several months serving as a hospital chaplain. The goal is to help us learn pastoral skills and to also help prepare us for things that we will encounter in the ministry. Specifically, we are led to find time to sit with somebody as they're dying. We spend time in emergency rooms with family members who've just lost somebody, and other things. So during an assignment that I had in the intensive care unit, I met a family whose son had tried to hang himself. He was 19. The chances of his survival were low. After about a week, the family decided that it was time to take him off of life support, and they asked me to accompany them during that process. They hoped that they would be able to donate some of his organs. In order for that to be possible, though, he would have to die within minutes of the machines being turned off. But because he was so young, it was likely that he might miss that window. So this put me in a position of praying with his parents that their son would die quickly so that others might live. That was the day that I became a minister. And anything that you think about what that experience was like is probably true. So about a week after his death, the many hospital employees that had been a part of that experience came together for a debriefing meeting. And I attended with my supervisor and with a colleague who had supported me on that day. We learned that his retinas, his kidneys, and one of his lungs had been successfully donated. And after a year, his parents would be able to contact those whose lives had been saved through their son's death. I found a lot of comfort in knowing that this young man who had chosen death had found a way out of his pain, and in doing so had given such a gift to five other people. To me, this was a positive outcome, perhaps the best possible outcome given the situation. And as the debriefing meeting went on, we were each asked to share our perspective. When it was my turn, I said basically what I just said to you. And a nurse looked at me like I had just said something horrible. And she said that she was still coming to terms with our collective failure. Heads nodded all around the room. My supervisor asked the nurse to share what she meant by failure. And the nurse said, well, we are trained to save lives. And so when we can't, that's a failure. And again, heads nodded all around the room. Perhaps this is not how all medical professionals feel, but it seemed to be the unanimous sentiment amongst those medical professionals. And the more that I've dealt with death professionally, it seems medical profession feel as well. We're meant to be alive, and death is the enemy. I find that attitude toward death unhelpful and frankly unhealthy. Death is not the enemy. It is not a failure. Death is not something that should only be spoken of in hushed tones and covered up in euphemisms. Death is inevitable. It is natural. It is simply a part of life. If we view all of the normal parts of a full human life through the lens of shame and failure, we are prevented from making peace with various aspects of our existence. Birth, sex, death, these are all just normal parts of being alive. Therefore, we have nothing to feel ashamed of talking about. When we cover death with a shroud of fear and shame, we don't learn how to talk about it. And we don't develop a language for grief. When faced with the death of a loved one, and we have no language, no framework for coping with it, our unease can push us into a shame spiral, increasing our isolation during a difficult time. Additionally, feelings that are not properly acknowledged tend to come out sideways as self-destructive behaviors. When people are grieving and they don't know how, they make reckless choices, become emotionally unpredictable, and often turn to numbing behaviors. We live in a culture that is more comfortable with people binge drinking than talking about their feelings. And that breaks my heart. It breaks my heart for a person who can't express their pain, and so they choose numbing behaviors, and it breaks my heart for everyone who has to watch them go through that. And haven't we all been on both sides of that equation? But there is another path. Practice with intention. We can build the emotional muscles to cope with death in an honest and a healthy way. It will always hurt. At no point does the death of a loved one become easy. It will always hollow out your heart. But we don't have to experience that emptiness as something bad and scary. Hollowness and spaciousness are the same thing, just seen through different lenses. To paraphrase Khalil Gibran, the more the pain hollows you out, the more space you have for joy. Joy is what comes later when we're able to transmute that pain. And just as the tragedy of that young man's death was also the gift of life for five other people, the loss of a loved one can be the gift of a true spiritual experience for any of us. So much opens up to us if we allow ourselves to really feel what we're feeling. Even the things that we're not comfortable feeling or that we don't want to feel it anyway. We're told not to feel sad or angry or confused, and especially don't feel lost. I encourage you to disabuse yourself of that toxic message now. No emotion is wrong. It is okay to feel however you feel. It can't always act on how you feel, but you can feel how you feel. And can we really say that we made the most of our lives, that we really did it, if we refuse to experience part of what it is to be human? Beloved, we were given a full, beautiful, challenging spectrum of emotions so that we could paint with them all. As we allow ourselves to discover all of the hues of life's rich tapestry, we discover more about ourselves. And as we discover more about ourselves, we learn to relate to each other in new ways. When we grow, our relationships grow. When we allow ourselves to be broken open and revealed by grief, we give others the chance to love us more deeply. Grief helps us find new depths in our hearts and our souls, which we can then fill with the love and care of others. Through the loss of one source of love, we find ourselves able to turn to new sources of love, discover deeper levels of interconnectedness with those around us. As Unitarian Universalists, we affirm and promote respect for the interdependent web of all existence of which we are a part. That means that we are never truly alone. We are bound to each other, to all humanity, at a primal level. And here in this church, we have bound ourselves together on another level through covenantal agreements. Here we have explicitly agreed to love and support one another. We may not always agree, we may not all get along, but we will always be a community of mutual support and love. When we are faced with the harder, colder times of life, the ties of community, and specifically this community, hold us in comfort and warmth. When the landscape has turned hard and gray, and the trees are bare, and the fields are yellow-brown, we know the world is not dead. It is sleeping. The roots of living things are growing. The animals are snuggled up somewhere together. Life does not end. It waits. It finds its way again, always, and always. Sometimes spring may seem so far away, but we know there has never once been a winter that wasn't followed by a spring. In the depths of sorrow and loss, may we be reminded of our incredible resilience. May we know the stretching of heartache that leads to a greater capacity to love. May we be held in the warmth and comfort of loving community. May it be so. Amen.